When you do ask questions, that will be part of the live stream. So we want everybody to be aware of that and be mindful. I don't think anybody would use any racy language or anything like that. But please keep that in mind. Tonight's program, we do have three speakers that we will move through quite quickly. And afterwards, for those of you who have time, we have a wonderful cake outside. I will repeat much of this for our live audience. I apologize. A reminder before we get much further to turn off your electronic devices. We do have reception in the 4D theater. We're happy about that. At times we're sad about that. And for the questions, please raise your hand and we will come around with the microphone. We won't give you the microphone. We generally hold it and then we take it back because you get hijacked every once in a while. So that's what's going on there. So we will start at 6:30 promptly, because that's when the stream starts.
That's in 3 minutes.
That's in three minutes. As far as other housekeeping items, if you do need to use the washroom, you can go out the doors at the back of the theater, and we propped open. And we will have people continuing to fill in from the back of the theater, just so you're aware of what's
seconds away though.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the Vancouver Aquarium Marine Science Center. Thank you so much for coming to join us this evening. It's a beautiful night outside in Vancouver, and we really appreciate you taking the time to celebrate with us. Celebrate World Oceans Day, celebrate the 25th anniversary of the Georgia Strait Alliance, and take this great opportunity to hear from these amazing speakers that we have lined up for you this evening. So World Oceans Day actually launched in 1992. At the Earth Summit in Rio. And it was a product of many NGOs coming together, a planning exercise, and a recognition that oceans are critical to our well-being. It's not just about every other breath we breathe. It's not just about the fish we eat. It's also about how we get around, and it's one of our biggest connectors to nature. Tonight, we're pleased to be joined by several people who are absolutely passionate about the Salish Sea. And for those of you who don't know, that's the water body that is the Strait of Georgia, the Strait of Juan de Fuca, and Puget Sound. And we're lucky to have folks who've done a tremendous amount of research and exploration of these sites, so they're going to tell some of their stories. Our partner this evening is the Georgia Strait Alliance, who I mentioned earlier is celebrating their 25th anniversary. They've been dedicated to caring for the Salish Sea and working across government organizations, NGOs, and local communities to improve the quality of that habitat. So from bringing stakeholders together on Vancouver's waterfront to educating boaters about best practices, they have been committed to making sure this water body is protected for future generations. And with that, I'd like to introduce Christiane Wilhelmsen, the Executive Director of the Georgia Strait Alliance. Thank you.
Thanks, everyone, and thank you so much for joining us tonight and celebrating Georgia Strait Alliance's 25th anniversary. 25 years ago, a group of people living on Vancouver Island decided that they didn't like what they were seeing in the Georgia Strait region. Pulp mill pollution, sewage pollution, habitat loss, just a lot of threats, and there was no single voice speaking for the health and the future of the Georgia Strait. And that is why the Georgia Strait Alliance was born. We were born not to protest against something, but to talk about what we wanted something to be, what we wanted to be for. And in our 25 years, it's been about identifying threats, but also talking about the solutions of how we can mitigate those threats and make a better future for our region. And it's that in that vein tonight that this is one of several projects the Georgia Strait Alliance and the Vancouver Aquarium have been working on together. Just a couple of months ago, actually, I guess it was just a couple of months ago, we partnered with the Vancouver Aquarium to bring together scientists, not-for-profits, academics, managers, government officials to talk about toxic contamination in our waters and the impacts they were having on marine mammals. But not just to talk about the contaminants, but to talk about the solutions that we, as agents of change, can actually make happen. Not waiting for someone else to do something about it, but acting ourselves. It was a very, very powerful day, and we walked away committed to making change in the future. Now, nothing underscores the essential work that we do together more than the fuel spill that took place in English Bay in April. The need for timely oil spill response paired with ongoing monitoring of our oceans is critical and really essential in this day and age. So we're really proud that the Georgia Strait Alliance and Vancouver Aquarium's Coastal Ocean Research Institute are both at the forefront of oil spill response advocacy as well as monitoring of this ocean. And I want to thank the Aquarium for being such great partners. Now, tonight's event starts with a presentation by the Vancouver Aquarium's Howe Sound Research Group on the biodiversity surveys that have been conducted here for the last few years. We will also have the Canadian premiere of the screening of The Unknown Sea, a documentary film about the Salish Sea. And afterwards, we'll hear from authors of a new book about the jewel that is the Salish Sea and what inspired them to write the book. Of course, after our presentation, please join us outside for refreshments and cake, because you can't have a birthday party without cake. Now, our first speaker tonight is Dr. Jeff Marliev, Vice President of Marine Science at the Vancouver Aquarium. Dr. Marliev has been monitoring marine life in Howe Sound for over 30 years and has written numerous publications. Dr. Marliev.
Thank you. What I want to do in particular tonight is to talk about a subject that people tend to get concerned about, and I want to try and relate it to the biology of my part of the Salish Sea, which is Howe Sound, right outside of Vancouver. And you've probably heard in the news that we're starting in on an El Nino, and we always hear about climate change and think in terms of burning fossil fuels and changing the climate in one direction. I'm going to try and put it in the context of climate regime shifts, which are naturally occurring phenomena, but we have to remember that we don't really have a way of knowing how much human-induced climate change will interact with climate regime shifts. So that's specifically what I wanted to get at. And our Howe Sound research program is basically a whole bunch of fun diving where we get to look at different types of animals. And we're just now becoming sort of born again El Nino believers, and we're starting to relate everything we see to climate. And I think that's really exciting. It makes it fun, but it also gives pause for serious concern. So going back, this gets nerdy for a while, I've been warned. We do have long-term biodiversity records for seabed, and there are four known climate regime shifts, and White Cliff Park is the most famous dive site, and we're only looking at the original 328 species that we knew for sure back where that blue bar was. And you can see that the last decade of the previous century had a high biodiversity, and then it actually came down. So we're very interested that we see biodiversity shifts going in sync with climate regime shifts. And I'm not, this is just a little self-serving. There's a bunch of biodiversity. The purple represents Strait of Juan de Fuca, which is fully exposed outer coast. And then down below, Puget Sound, of course, very well-known body of water. The Strait of Georgia, and then Johnstone Strait. Because if you look at those compared to West Coast Vancouver Island, you get characteristic differences in biodiversity. And so this is the part that gets a little bit tough. But the upper left-hand corner is West Coast Vancouver Island. And if you look at the green bars, that's the decade of the 90s. And then down below that, Strait of Georgia. And then the upper right is Johnstone Strait. And below that, Puget Sound. And you can see that in all these different areas, we had a higher biodiversity in that last decade. And so something seems to be going on. Now, hindsight being 2020, we're realizing that this particular species, the sunflower star, is probably what you would call a keystone predator. A very important predator that has the capability of killing almost anything. And, you know, we can't display them at the Vancouver Aquarium with any other kind of animal because they can kill almost anything, eat almost anything. But notice also the date. This is taken up Indian Arm, October 9th, 2013. And, in fact, we have records showing that they were already in a population collapse at this point. But nobody was really noticing, not even us. We have records that indicate that. But October 9th, 2013, this is the exact same rock on October 29th, thanks to Neil McDaniel. And what you see in the foreground, there's a blade of kelp with a little teeny tiny baby sunflower star, which didn't seem to be susceptible to what turned out to be a type of virus. But those drifts of white, that's necrotic debris. And we just had rivers of ossicles and such. And this was so gross because of the upper corner, the sea star literally falling apart in front of your eyes, that everybody noticed it. It's really hideous. Just now, Guayanas, the Queen Charlotte Islands, have been hit hard this spring, and they're reporting all the same sorts of things. Didn't happen exactly everywhere, thank heavens, but Joe's just telling me the San Juan Islands never really got up to such ridiculous proportions. But now we can understand why biodiversity went down a bit during the first decade after the turn of the millennium, because that is when the sunflower star exploded. For a whole decade, they were ridiculously abundant. Immediately after that collapse, this is taken late October, and we were seeing little thumbnail-sized green urchins. And some experts are telling us, oh, green urchins can't grow very fast. They were hiding. They came out of hiding. Well, no, I'm sorry. We're starting to think that the sunflower star is a keystone predator on urchins in particular. The sea stars and the urchins are echinoderms, so they belong to the same group, and they have that one characteristic of being capable of undergoing real population explosions. So, if you want to talk about ecology, the sunflower star is an important predator that is controlling green urchins, which are herbivores, and the third photo down is of a garum, a type of kelp which in this part of the world is the exclusive nursery habitat for the spot prawn, the luscious crustacean that we like to eat. So, sunflower star is having a negative impact on the green urchin, but the green urchin is having a negative impact on the kelp, right? And the kelp has a positive impact on the prawns. So, what that means is those sunflower stars are actually doing a good thing for the kelp beds and for the prawns. So, without them, it means the urchins are bad news for the kelp beds and for the prawns. We have, for the first time ever, witnessed what I would call recruitment failure, that is failure of settlement for the second year in a row. May, June is when they settle. And actually, this is a shame because this is a good year for reproduction for the spot prawn. Lots of little babies trying to settle, but we have these tiny little remnant patches of kelp where they're successfully settling and nowhere else. So, with 2 years of reproductive failure, the spot prawn, being hermaphroditic, is going to wind up next year with essentially an all-female population, which leads to what you could call a negative feedback loop, where the females won't be getting their eggs fertilized. So I decided not to wait until after the fact, say, oh, I knew that. I have made an announcement a while back, and I'm not too popular with the prawn fleet, but I'm saying that by 2018, there will probably be a fishery collapse in Howe Sound. I was just on Valdez Island. Joe tells me the San Juans are like the South Gulf Islands. They never really had that level of sunflower star explosion, and so they don't really have the urchin barrens, and they do have the kelp. So prawn fishermen can go to the South Gulf Islands instead of Howe Sound, I guess. I don't know. I hope so. I want to switch quickly to one of our favorite subjects for biologists in Howe Sound. That's the cloud sponge, because they're also slapping us in the face. Say, yeah, it's climate, buddy. Pay attention. This is a cloud sponge growing on rocks. That's called a sponge garden. And this is around 2011. In 2009, 2010, we saw this sponge die in front of our eyes. It was really upsetting to see, but it didn't entirely die. And it started recovering. Well, its tissue failure started in the fall of 2009, which is a big El Nino. And then 2012-13, we had La Nina winters, and all the sponges were rebounding. And sponge bioherms are the same types of sponges that grow on dead bodies of sponges, geologically stabilized by silt. And this is pictures taken by me in Howe Sound at 100 feet depth. This is the only place in the entire world where a scuba diver on compressed air can get to these sponge reefs. So it's really fun to be able to look at them. And we're starting to realize that there are some misconceptions that by chance relate to what we didn't used to be able to really understand. We understood what an El Nino was, but now you can go online, and as of today, La Jolla is saying that, you know, the next increment was up 0.7. So we're officially into an El Nino. Now, this is fishing gear damage. It's something that's also upsetting. We've seen lots of fishing gear damage. And in May of 2012, which was La Nina, this is just a fishing line from a salmon downrigger that sliced through this part of a sponge. But by December, it was recovering. Now, there's a literature, and I'm guilty. I'm one of the people who published about extremely slow growth and all, saying that they can't recover. The tissue damage is permanent, you know, really, really delicate. By luck of the draw, all those papers were published on observations made during El Niños. So we've been looking during a La Niña. It's been pretty exciting because we're seeing what I would call episodic rapid growth. And so just like Sea Dog Society, we're calling in citizen scientists because you can't expect taxpayers to do everything. And we've just had a bunch of really expert tech divers go out, and we have these PVC pipes with barcodes on them, and we're saying you have to take pictures with the barcode in the frame or else we can't make any sense of it. And they got it right, and this is a video taken on probably the only day we've ever had with absolutely perfect visibility from the surface down. Maybe the sound's a mistake, Donna, but Donna was in, she's in the crowd, and she was excited, so you can see that the frame of the video is shaking. This is a new technology where you can make the video stabilized, but this is a reef that was really bouncing back, growing really robustly. We had seen this reef collapse in the El Nino, 2009-2010, growing back very rapidly. And I'm sorry to say that these other people were helping us. We're seeing right now that with the El Nino started again, the tissues are collapsing again. So we're seeing the second collapse, and we think we understand it. But it means that instead of being growing at a geological, imperceptible rate, these reefs are bouncing up, crashing, which is probably good news because we know that fishing gear causes them to crash, and we're hoping they can bounce back if they get the protection. But you can see the mound of mud on dead bodies. These reefs were thought to have gone extinct in the Jurassic. They really only exist to a great extent in British Columbia, and I want you to memorize this one factoid coming out of the University of Alberta. In British Columbia, they remove 230 tons of bacteria every day. That's a good job. So they have their own ecological worth. And the other thing we're finding, this is, I call it the one green snake. See this spike, this tall column right there? it collapsed of its own weight during the last year, and as of this last week, it's totally disintegrating. So it's falling apart because we're in an El Nino. Had it fallen down during a La Nina, it would have had a chance to keep growing. And so, technically speaking, these all being single-celled animals, it could be their tissue is immortal, which is kind of exciting. But we're unhappy that we're seeing a lot of necrosis during an El Nino, but we're kind of excited that we finally got it figured out that we'll be able to do something. And we're also very excited that the diving community can do really valid documentation, because you just can't expect that taxpayer dollars are going to do everything there is to do. There's just too much in this world. And so right after this video, I'm going to show you a still from a video frame taken during spring of 2010. And I thought everything was fine. I wasn't noticing it. But the lower parts, you can see sort of a dark complexion to it. And that's tissue that was dying. And then the more lively parts on top would come tumbling down. And this is a couple of freeze frames from that same video. And we know exactly where this particular spot is because we had a couple black PVC pipes in. And the upper right, that is a fragment of dead sponge with live sponge attached that had fallen down the slope. We put the pipes in that part because there were no sponges. We thought it was a safe reference point for us. And after the La Niñas, all those supposedly dead fragments have grown up into this nice ridge of sponge, and those are our two black stakes. So that was kind of exciting to document, and I'm afraid we may be documenting the opposite very shortly. So thank you very much. If there are any questions, I'd be happy to try and answer.
In the middle.
Oh, the question is, how can you end up with mostly female spot prawns? Okay, they are strict protandric hermaphrodites. They first mature as a male, and then they turn into females. So, unfortunately, they're a species with a characteristically big population. There are other types of shrimp related to them that always have some individuals functioning as one sex during any birth year. But that's the price of being a robust species that has characteristically huge populations that support fisheries. Yes? Yeah.
Scale, that cone, that piece of sponge that you were talking about that fell over, how big was it?
Okay, the question is, how big was the piece of sponge that fell over? And it was over a meter tall. And there's a question from the guy behind.
What type of data are citizen scientists most useful in gathering?
Ah, that's a good question. What kind of data are citizen scientists most useful in gathering? Depends on your belief sets. There are some scientists who would claim that there's nothing that can be done by anyone who doesn't have a PhD, but that's why I always like to get people to take a photograph with something in the frame that would stand up in a court of law, and that's exactly why we put these barcode stakes in. And some people didn't get it because they're ashamed of themselves if there's any snow in the picture, and so they get closer and closer until they have a gorgeous photograph that is scientifically useless, or they see a fish and they take a portrait photo. Give me a break. Joe's going to show you lots of pictures of pretty fish. But so anyway, that's one good thing. But there are lots of things citizen scientists can do, and that's one thing that SeaDoc Society is very active with. It's one thing Coastal Ocean Research is going to be leaning more and more heavily on. And, of course, Georgia Strait Alliance is all about that. I think we're not allowed too many questions, so this will be the last.
You went very quickly through that whole barcode.
Well, that's the why we, you can ask the ladies down the row from you afterward, but we've got a book chapter that's online that's free download. And this Vanity Press stuff is cool because within a year we had over 2,000 downloads, and that doesn't happen when you pay a journal to publish. Thank you.
You might even be able to get Joe to autograph that for you. Thank you very much, Dr. Marliev. Our next speaker is Kevin Campion, and we're delighted he drove 6 hours today to get here. Had some fun at the border, managed to check into his hotel in less than 10 minutes in order to come this evening and introduce his film. Now, Kevin is the captain of the education sailing vessel Orion and is a lifelong resident of the Pacific
Northwest, and I'm going to invite him up to introduce his film, The Unknown Sea.
Okay, I will keep it sweet. Thank you. I'll keep it real brief here because you guys are going to hear me talk for about a half hour's worth of the film. But I will say it's very special to be here, one, celebrating the 25th anniversary of Georgia Straits Alliance. I have huge respect for that organization and benefit from the work you guys do every day when I'm out there sailing on the Salish Sea. And also, it's pretty cool for me to be here showing my film at Vancouver Aquarium. I came here for the first time when I was in sixth grade, when that summer I went to whale camp at Western Washington University, and we took a one-day field trip up here to the Vancouver Aquarium, and I was blown away by what I saw, and I think that was pretty formative in, you know, here I am back, you know, teaching students about the Salish Sea and you know, kind of giving back. So thanks to Vancouver Aquarium for having me and for doing what you guys do. So. World Ocean Day, we have a pretty sweet spot or sweet corner of the Pacific Ocean right here in the Salish Sea. We'll take you guys on a little tour over the next half hour. Thank you for coming out.
So important to our lives. They identify and distinguish us. They tie us to the past and help define our future. My name is Alexi, and that probably won't change. Turns out name changes have happened throughout history, from famous artists to entire countries. I grew up in the foothills of Mount Rainier, and I identify with its snow-capped peak and evergreen forests just as much as I identify with the name Alexi. Which is why I was so intrigued when I saw this.
A ceremony filled with song, prayer, and praise marked a new chapter in West Coast history this morning. As of today, the coastal waters that surround Vancouver Island, the mainland, and parts of Washington State will be known as the Salish Sea.
This is an important renaming right in my backyard, and I want to learn more about it. Why was it changed? Why the name Salish? What does it mean for the area and the people who call it home? A few years back, I met Kevin Campion, captain of the famed sailboat Orion. Kevin takes students from across the country voyaging into these coastal waters to explore and research them. This year, he has put together an expedition to navigate the Salish Sea and talk to the folks who know it best. I am lucky enough to be joining them on board as science intern.
I think of the Salish Sea, I think of the body of water that is Puget Sound, the Straits of Juan de Fuca, the San Juan Islands, the Straits of Georgia. So that's from like Olympia, Bud Inlet down south, all the way up to Quadra Island in the north. It's bordered by the Skagit and the Whidbey Island, and Vancouver and the Fraser on the east, and then
all the way out west to Nia Bay and Port Renfrew at the entrance of the Straits of Juan de Fuca.
In addition to these bodies of water, the Salish Sea is 7,000 kilometers of coastline, home to 37 species of marine-dependent mammals, including the 8 million humans who live along its shores. It is 17,000 square kilometers of sea shared by US and Canada. Of course, the 247 species of fish that swim in these waters don't recognize the border. To establish a sense of place takes years. We're going out with Orion and her crew to answer the questions, what is this place? And why rename it?
Having a sailboat is the coolest way to get out on the Salish Sea. And having Orion, who is this living piece of history, is such a great way to go explore the area. So Orion was built in 1934 at the Henry B. Nevins Shipyard. Her designer, Olin Stevens, designed some of the most famous ocean racing boats of the 30s and 40s, one of which is Orion. Orion is 64 feet long, 13 feet wide, 8 feet deep underwater, and 75 feet above the water with a mast. So you never quite know what someone's going to be like to sail with until they're on board. Sailing with a chief mate, Chris Day, is like sailing with a do-it-yourself encyclopedia. He knows how to do just about everything to anything that ever needs having something done to it.
All right, Leon, we'll take you back on board.
All right, I'm headed over, over.
See you later, over, over.
Chief Engineer Shaughnessy Leon Schneider is priceless, and sailing with her is also priceless.
Someone's in here.
It's easy to get things done, but hard to stay serious when she's on board. Chief Scientist Jess, she's explored so much of the Salish Sea underneath, reminds me that there's also that aspect, not just what we're seeing on the surface. Sailing intern Mr. Gunner is rad to have on board because he's always about three steps ahead of us with his humor. Our science intern Alexi's enthusiasm for marine mammals and the environment is so contagious.
Our journey begins in the historic seaport of Port Townsend, located on Admiralty Inlet at the north entrance of the Puget Sound. Pinched between the Cascade Mountains and the Pacific Ocean, the dynamic weather of the area this time of year can create a lot of challenges.
Got it.
Okay.
Cutting the ties from shore is always difficult, especially in the fog and snow.
In going on this voyage to learn more about the Salish Sea, I spent a lot of time thinking about why call it this different name? Why not just stick with Puget Sound, Straits of Georgia, all these names that we've had for a long time. And one of the things that really struck me the more I thought about it is how all these names are based on first Europeans here. And it just doesn't really relate to our concept of what the area is now. I don't think of an English explorer from the 1700s. I think of killer whales, and I think of marble murrelets. This name Salish certainly pays homage to the first people who were here. It's just a more accurate way to think of the area. People are inseparable from the Salish Sea. Like, we're here, we've made our mark, and so it's important to recognize that.
If you type in the words Salish Sea Research, Joe Gaydos is at the top of the list. We are on our way to meet with Joe on Orcas Island at the Sea Doc Society office. All on board are looking forward to meeting him, but we still have the Straits of Juan de Fuca between us and Orcas Island. Cattle Pass is the southern entrance to the San Juan Islands, between Lopez and San Juan Island. It's very well known for its strong currents and, as you can see, fog. Sailing in the fog is exciting. It's an all hands on deck experience. Someone on bow watch, someone watching the radar, and the entire crew has to have a heightened sense of awareness. Whale Rocks is a favorite hangout for stellars. The stellar sea lions are said to be the grizzly bears of the sea. The strong currents of Cattle Pass make it a favorite spot for them. The currents cause upwelling, which brings nutrient-rich waters to the surface, which means plenty of fish for the sea lions to eat.
Having the opportunity to pick Joe Gaydos' brain about the Salish is so cool. He gets this place better than anybody. He understands the politics of it, he understands the ecology, he understands the geology.
My name is Joe Gaydos, and I'm director of the Sea Doc Society. I'm a wildlife veterinarian, and I've been working in the Salish Sea for over a decade now. What we do at Sea Doc is we'll fund projects, and then we'll take the results of those projects and try and work with managers or policymakers to try and improve the way that we are handling natural resources in the Salish Sea area. I would say the Salish Sea is a really highly productive inland sea. It's 17,000 square kilometers of ocean. For me, you know, you look out, it's beautiful, it's fantastic, but to really know this place, you've got to look underwater. And it's really powered by this water that comes in from deep off the ocean in through the Strait of Juan de Fuca. You have fresh water that comes down from all of these mountain ranges that surround the Salish Sea, and that's nutrient rich. And with this complex undersea topography that's been crafted by glaciations, all of this water just mixes up. And then you get this really high productivity, plankton blooming. So you get all these invertebrates, all of these fishes, and then all of the birds that are eating those things, and then all of the mammals that come into that. So it's just this really dynamic, outstanding place that's like being in a tropical rainforest, but you're in a temperate sea.
We'll talk to you in the next week or so.
So it's really interesting to have the Salish Sea as a teaching tool to be able to bring students out into this environment that we all share and really show them on a first-hand basis that this is the place that we live. It's not our houses, it's not your neighborhood. We live in a much bigger world. Whether we be taking a hike on one of the San Juan Islands and, you know, identifying plants or mushrooms and taking a look at wildlife or taking observations about bird life that we see, marine mammals, etc. Things that you're being exposed to out on the water are very different than things you would be exposed to back at home.
Stewart Island is one of my favorite islands in the Salish Sea, and I'm a little sad to leave. However, it takes us a whole day to sail from Stewart Island to Bellingham. Our voyages on Orion are not only filled with adventures and sailing, there is always something to learn in our downtime. The day-long trip is a perfect time to practice traditional navigation with charts and compasses.
Students on board can use the boat as a research platform to go explore the various regions that aren't necessarily accessible to them.
Well, I've been on board Orion. I've seen quite a few spectacular mammals. The orcas are my personal favorite.
Right there! Right there! I've never in my life seen anyone more enthusiastic about seeing whales.
They are apex predators in our ecosystem, which means that they are on the very top of the food chain. They're very social animals. They live in pods. You're going to see them most often in places where the salmon are coming through because salmon is their primary food. Orcas and pretty much all cetaceans rely on their sense of hearing to find their food, to communicate, basically to survive. And so the adverse effects of noise just surrounding their everyday environment could potentially lead to starvation. And it is so very important to make sure that we are keeping the balance between keeping our lives comfortable and keeping the marine mammals safe. We have arrived in Bellingham and we are full of anticipation to meet Bert Weber, who is one of the key individuals responsible for the renaming of the Salish Sea.
There is this statistic that the total volume of the Salish Sea is exchanged once a year. So the amount of water that's moving out at the surface and in at depth through the Strait of Juan de Fuca is equal to the total volume of the Salish Sea. That to me is a fundamental backbone of this Salish Sea ecosystem. In the 80s part of the baseline studies that were being done to welcome Alaska oil into Cherry Point, it became clear that there was this thing, an ecosystem that tied together the Fraser River and the other rivers. The interaction of those rivers with the salt water created an estuarine ecosystem. Through the accumulation of that knowledge came the clarity that we in fact had an ecosystem that was worth protecting. A name that could foster this sense of place was something that was necessary. And this process for the Salish Sea actually started in the late 1980s. The Salish people were the first ones around what we're calling now the Salish Sea. It seemed appropriate that they're first in line be recognized by the name.
Okay, what a day, eh? Right on. The Salish Sea, whoa!
Whoa indeed. Adding the name Salish Sea to waters BC's First Nations have traversed for thousands of years may have been unthinkable a generation ago. Now, a new generation will grow up with a new sense of belonging.
It means a certain level of recognition of Indigenous people around the Salish Sea. I think that it is a strong statement from the Indigenous people that we need to work as a collective.
The Coast Salish people have been in this area for at least 8 or 9,000 years. Every summer for the past few decades, their canoe journey travels through the Salish Sea and outer Pacific coast. This well-known journey maintains human traditions almost as old as the Salish Sea itself.
It's pretty much everything that we've always known as Native people. All of us grew up on the water. It's part of who we are. It's part of our lives.
My primary interest is that people understand and develop an association or a sense of place with the Salish Sea so that we can better understand what the issues are for natural resource management.
I think one of the major threats is all the motorboats. In the spotlight lately is like the tar sands and the shipping of the oil. One of the stops they do is at Cherry Point, and they have one in Anacortes as well.
It was oil through the state of Washington's inland waters that brought the first interest in science and led to the naming of the Salish Sea, and now, full circle, we're back worrying about the transportation of oil.
There's always the threat of an oil spill. It would really damage a lot of our fishing areas.
We are sailing to Point Roberts,
a remnant of the British-American conflict over the continent and a true geopolitical oddity. When the 49th parallel was chosen as the border between present-day Canada and the United States, it was a small piece of Washington completely surrounded by Canadian mainland.
The fact that the United States can claim fishing waters that are very valuable, if it weren't for that, I suspect that probably there would have been a land swap of some kind by now, because it doesn't really make very much sense.
It's forgotten by most Washingtonians, except those that live there, and especially the kids who have to cross two borders to go to school every day.
So I'm pretty sure that falcon we saw was a Geer falcon. And the only reason I'm skeptical that it would be is because they're very rare. The
barn owl experience was pretty spectacular.
Yeah, that was. Let's look that guy up too. So the owl, I think the owl's like.
So it definitely looked me in the eye.
Yeah. Was it hunting in that little canal, and you could see it like coming up the canal.
We are leaving Point Roberts and crossing the border into Canada.
There's an arbitrary boundary between Washington and British Columbia. The animals don't think anything of it. The whales, the birds, the fishes, the plankton, everything moves across it. But for people, we seem to have a really big challenge with that.
This transboundary nature of the Salish Sea complicates conservation efforts. So down here in the United States, we could dump $1 billion into salmon conservation. If you have pollution in the Fraser River, which is regulated by Canada, our salmon that we even have this huge investment in are affected by that.
There's quite a wonderful sign at the mouth of the Fraser River. It says, water contaminated, do not swim.
The Fraser River is the longest river within British Columbia, from its headwaters on Mount Robson to its mouth in the city of Vancouver. It's the largest contributor of fresh water to the Salish Sea.
Probably 80% of the fresh water that comes into the Salish Sea comes from a single source, and that single source is the Fraser River.
The sheer volume of the Fraser River creates a plume of fresh water extending out into the Salish Sea. There is a distinct line where the two bodies of water meet.
So I got my bucket of what looks to be Fraser River water here. So this is a refractometer. This is it's what we use to test salinity on the boat. I'll put my drop on there. And it is at 18 parts per thousand. And typical seawater is like 28 to 32 ppt. It's definitely a little fresher. Let's see if we can prove it. Yeah, a little bit doesn't taste very good, but doesn't taste as salty as you'd expect for being in the Salish Sea.
As you go north in Georgia Strait, there is a place in which the oceanography changes radically. You go north of those narrows, the water becomes colder, and if you also notice, the vegetation on land becomes different. You don't see any more oaks or madrona.
As we head further north, I am thrilled about seeing the hat trick of Salish Sea wildlife. The grizzly bear, basking shark, and the humpback whale.
Desolation Sound is this place where Vancouver Island and the mainland get really, really close. You have all these islands in the middle.
Desolation Sound has undergone many changes in the last century, as different industries have gone boom and bust. Now home to Desolation Sound Marine Park, it is the wilderness that attracts us.
All right, we got this plan to catch bear, or to catch bear. We got this plan to catch bears. Let's say we happen to catch a bear, though. We're just going to roll with it, and he's part of the crew. We have an extra red hat.
that's bear size and has little holes for his ears. No, we got a plan to see bears. We're gonna go on this hike, and we're gonna bring our lucky bear totem, which is Oxnard, the ship's mascot. And where we're going is this really big, like, sedge meadow wetland right up to the salt water, and that's like prime bear habitat this time of year. You have grizzly bears on the mainland and on Vancouver Island. You have wolves, you have black bears, you have cougars. And not only do you have all these land predators, you have ocean predators as well. You have your killer whales, you have your stellar sea lions. We saw stellars today coming through hole in the wall. We're in a place that is healthy and can support these species. These are all species that we had in Puget Sound and San Juan Islands up to 100 years ago, and they're not there anymore. And the reason they're not there is because, one, they've been hunted, no bueno, but the ecosystem in that part of the Salish Sea isn't able to support these big predators. And not having those predators in the environment just makes it less wild. Being up here feels significantly different than being at anchor in Reed Harbor and Stewart Island. Tonight, at anchor, we could hear wolves howl. Having that opportunity is really special to me, and I think especially everyone else on board.
Out hole in the wall, through the Octopus Islands and into our anchorage, which is at Wyatt Bay. Wyatt Bay is Oxnard approved.
My name is Dana Haggerty. I'm currently a PhD candidate at the University of British Columbia. I'm doing a project to look at the effectiveness of rockfish conservation areas in British Columbia. Rockfish conservation areas were set up in the mid-2000s to protect and hopefully bring back rockfish populations.
We're gonna launch and then figure out a snorkel dive rotation here.
In the kelp forest, you'll see fishes that you think you would see very deep, like a lingcod or a rockfish, and sometimes they're in there at 10 or 12 feet.
Out of all of the other fish species, the rockfish were kind of most similar to tropical fish. Very obvious when you're scuba diving around them.
It's just so dense with animals, and it's, you know, it's three-dimensional. It's a fantastic place to snorkel.
As a diver, you get to see under the surface the variety of ecosystems the Salish Sea bring. From the kelp forest to eelgrass beds to sand dunes and cliffs that go 300 feet into the abyss.
The Octopus Islands are the northern end of our journey, and if we keep going north, we will soon be out of the Salish Sea. Time to up anchor and head south. All on board agree that it has been an epic journey so far. Some corners of the Salish Sea have shown a healthy and vibrant ecosystem, and others clearly show the impact of the humans that live on its shore. Of course, we're all a little disappointed that we haven't seen a basking shark, bear, or humpback whale. The Salish Sea was once home to so many whales that there was a whaling industry in the Straits of Georgia. All the Salish Sea whaling stations were closed more than 100 years ago, but whaling stations remained on the outer coast into the 1960s. One of the whaling boats was even named Orion. The decimated population of this long-lived animal make it easy to imagine why they are just now returning to this area.
Last three summers, we've had humpback whales spend their whole summer in the Salish Sea. That's the first time in 40 years, 50 years, something like that, that's happened. The components are here
to have this sort of thriving ecosystem.
Oh, there it is.
Every person from Spokane to Nia Bay to Nanaimo has to be paying attention and aware that this area is in their charge, and the decisions they make, whether they're voting, whether they're putting something down the drain, all those decisions affect this entire ecosystem. We have the opportunity to do right by this place and to keep it healthy and to keep it functioning. And we also have the opportunity to do wrong by it. There's no time like the present to get people thinking about the Salish as a whole. We have proposed coal terminal. We have this proposed pipeline. We have coal trains. We have the Elwha Dam coming down. There's all these things that are sort of good and bad that are happening in the Salish. It of course affects the immediate place, but it also affects the Salish as a whole. It's worth saving, you know, it's worth considering when you go to the polls. There's not another Salish Sea.
The Salish Sea is the same regardless of its name. The ecosystem is the same. The wildlife has no concept of political borders. It's our perception that changes. The name Salish Sea blurs our ideas of borders as well. I have always identified with the mountains as my home, but now the Salish Sea is part of that identity. My name is still Alexi. The Puget Sound is still the sound, but we're part of a larger ecosystem, and I'm a better steward because I know that.
Does anyone have any questions for Kevin? He's right here. He's going to come up and join. We just wanted to see if there were any questions before he got him out of his comfy seat.
What's the technical name for the array of masts? Catch yaw?
So the rig design for Orion is a yaw. Yeah, so when the mizzen mast or the back mast is shorter than the forward one, and behind the steering wheel or the rudder post, then it's a yaw. Yeah.
There was a question at the back.
Is the film available to be shown to Nature Club?
Oh, it is, yes. And your daughter, I bet, knows how to get a hold of me, and I would love to get you a copy for that purpose. Yeah, either to download or I can send you a DVD.
There was a question.
Oh, copy that.
Steven?
Congratulations. I remember you showing at the Salish Sea Conference.
I think it was like a 10-minute piece or something. It's great to see it done. Who paid for it?
So the question is, how was the film funded? We were fortunate enough to have a pretty successful couple years of charter business that gives us a little extra funds that were burning a hole in our bank account. The Campion Foundation, which is my parents, are primarily served to promote conservation, and they helped pay for some as well. And then we got a lot, a whole lot of volunteer labor and camera work. You can trade sailing lessons for camera work, as it turns out.
Okay, we'll take one more.
Yeah. In the back there.
In your opinion, how does the future look for the Salish Sea?
So the question is, in my opinion, how does the future look for the Salish Sea? So I think it looks fantastic in that there's lots of people that are seeking out information and getting informed and getting engaged. I think the next 5 years, maybe, it will be pretty interesting, and the amount of fossil fuels that are looking to be exported out of the Salish Sea on both sides of the border. And it seems there's not one project that has a green light yet, and all those are meeting opposition. And yeah, I think it looks good because people are engaged, but time will tell.
So you can see why we decided to show that film. It really underscores the complexity, the richness, and the beauty of the Salish Sea. And as an advocacy and education organization, the Georgia Strait Alliance relies heavily on scientists to feed into our work to ensure that our advocacy and education is based on science, on what is actually happening, and then we can tell the stories that connect with people like you about the value of protecting this jewel. So it's my great pleasure to introduce one of the leading scientists who has really helped us, who's fed our work with the work of the Sea Doc Society. If you don't know the Sea Doc Society, I highly encourage you to visit their website. Their research is cutting edge, relevant, and so valuable to the work we do. So it's my privilege to introduce Dr. Joe Gaydos, Director and Chief Scientist at the Sea Doc Society on Orcas. And Dr. Gaydos has recently finished his book, The Salish Sea, as you know, with his co-author, Audrey Dalella Benedict. Joe.
Okay, thanks for having us tonight. Audrey and I do want to tell you some extraordinary tales from the Salish Sea. But before we get started in that, I just want to talk about the word ecosystem. Kevin in his film painted a nice picture of that concept, but it's a word that we all implicitly know, but we don't use it a lot. We don't come back from vacation and say, how was Hawaii? Oh man, that place, it's an amazing ecosystem. You need to check it out. But we know what that means, right? So if I tell you about an ecosystem, if I say, let's think about the Everglades, immediately you're going to think of a place that's freshwater. You're going to think of American alligators. If you are really into reptiles, you'll think of American crocodiles as well. There's 500 or so left there. You're going to think of strange birds that look like snakes, like the anhinga or purple gallinu, or wading birds like white ibis. You're going to think of sawgrass. You're going to think of fresh water. And it's maybe a place that many of the intrepid in you have been before and braved the mosquitoes and taken pictures, or maybe it's on your life list. But I want to remind you that the Everglades wasn't always that way. In fact, when people first found the Everglades, it was a swamp. And it was a place that needed to be drained. It was a place that didn't have any value. You couldn't grow crops there. People couldn't settle there. And it was really this book by Marjorie Stoneman Douglas in the 1940s called Everglades, The River of Grass, that really changed people's perception about the Everglades. And what she did in this book, she took the power of the written word, and she explained to people the way that the ecosystem worked. And people began to know the ecosystem and understand it and connect to it. And then all of a sudden, it started to have a value in and to itself. And people started realizing that this is important for us. It's important for society. It's important for water quality and all of these things. And this is really what Audrey and I were trying to do when we put together this book on the Salish Sea. We wanted to create a book that gave people the ability to know a place, to connect to a place, and then ultimately want to protect that place. And like Marjorie Stoneman Douglas, we had the power of the written word, but we also had the power of photographs. And when we put this book together, we wanted every picture, we wanted people to open this book up anywhere and then want more, and then be drawn to the words to learn the stories. And we were fortunate that we have 55 photographers. Any photographers here tonight? Yeah, thank you both for that. We juried over 6,000, I think 6,100 photographs to get the 233 or so that we have in there. And I knew we reached a really good point when we had a little bit of a phone argument one day where we were all on the line, and it was late in production, and we were going through photos, and we all kind of realized that we had a couple of favorite images that weren't going to make it into the book. And we got a little, at least I did, I got a little snippy. I was like, what about this one of that? And everyone else chimed in, what about this one? And then I realized, look, this is where we really wanted to be. We wanted to have so many of these sushi quality photos, so good you could just eat them, right? That we had ones that we couldn't get into the book. So I want to give a big shout out, or at least a little shout out, to all 55 photographers that are in that book there. And then I want to just let you know that the genesis for this book came about in a funny way. I'm not native to this area. Moved here in 2001 and just fell in love with this place, and have just been on this huge learning curve to learn about this place. And it's almost been like drinking from a fire hose. And when this place was named, as Bert Weber described in Kevin's film in 2008, 2009, I knew at that point that we needed to do something. We needed to put this place on the map for the people that lived here, but also for the people around the world, because it is an international treasure. People needed to know about it. And that's when I was fortunate. I became friends with Audrey. And she invited me to come speak on a boat one night when she has cloud-ridden naturalist, and she was having this tour, and she said, would you come give a lecture? We became friends. And not long after that, she said, hey, Joe, have you ever considered doing a book on the Salish Sea? And I said, Audrey, I think about doing a book on the Salish Sea all the time, but I have trouble writing my grocery list. And how do I go about doing that? And she said, look, I have a publishing company, and I've written books. And she showed me this book that she put together a few years back, Valley of the Dunes. And this book was very instrumental in getting the Great Sand Dunes in Colorado declared a national monument. And I looked through this book, and it was just eye candy. And I thought, gosh, if we can do something half as good as this book, it would be fantastic. And I remember the day that I wrote a proposal to Audrey, and I came home, and my wife, she said, well, you look pretty excited. I said, yeah, I had a great day today. And I kind of told her about the book, because it wasn't really just signing up with Audrey, it was signing up with her team. She had Wendy Chatil, who was the photo curator. She had Annie Dowden, who was the layout person. And then she also had an editor, Alice Levine, who was beautiful in that she could take every single thing I wrote and just trash it and make me feel entirely good about the whole process. And she could take my word and Audrey's written word and kind of mend them together. So I'm gonna let Audrey tell you, start a little bit with the story about the geology, and then I'm gonna step back in. Audrey?
I wanted to find a way, as I started out my scientific work in geology, and I eventually moved into biology and combined the two, because I really felt that combination, it sets the stage for the landscapes and the seascapes that move us all. But I wanted to find a way to tell a very complex story in the Salish Sea, and that's the geologic story. And it's multi-layered, it's a tapestry, really. And we all walk beaches, don't we? For some of us, it's addictive, it's like meditation. But when this is a little patch of beach at Birch Bay State Park, so just south of the US-BC border, and I did a work trip with Wendy, and we walked this stretch of beach because I was trying to find a way to capture the diversity of the geologic story on a beach. Every single rock you see here, every cobble, is a story. It's a chapter in an autobiography that's as exciting as anywhere in the world. And it takes us from the deepest depths where plate tectonics occurs, to the highest some of the highest volcanoes in North America, to the glaciers that scoured these landscapes and put it all together. And for these rocks on this beach, this is just the last stopping point in a very long journey, maybe 220 million years of time, because it's pretty young landscape in geologic terms. So from the highest glaciated summits of the North Cascades and the volcanoes that grace its crest, to the intertidal zone, the wave-washed rocks that we all love to explore with our families, to the deep oceans whose topography is every bit as exciting as the high mountains that rim the Salish Sea. And it's one word you might want to take away from this talk tonight is geodiversity. We all talk about biodiversity, but the Salish Sea is what it is because of the geologic setting and history that shaped it. So think geodiversity as the key to the rich biodiversity that makes this one of the most unique inland seas in the world.
So I know it's World Ocean Day and everybody's ready to get wet and salty. But I want to keep telling the story from the perspective of the forest for a minute. And because without the forest, we wouldn't really have the Salish Sea. So as Kevin explained in the film, it's an estuary. It's really a mixing zone between fresh water and salt water. And that fresh water, it's not rainfall down and hitting the ocean. It's rainfall that comes down in this huge sponge forest that surrounds the Salish Sea. And a lot of times people have trouble grasping that. And I said, well, let's start with the salmon. Because we're the southernmost latitude where we have all five species of Pacific salmon. And these salmon, they start their lives in the upper reaches of these streams and rivers. And then they travel out, depending what species they are and where they are, what run they are, they travel out into the open ocean. They put about 99% of their biomass on in the open ocean. And then after 2 or 5 or 7 years, they're traveling back up those rivers and streams, spawning, dying, depositing those nutrients right back in that soil that's then feeding that force that's going on. So that connection is there. And if that's still hard, think of this. Some people look at this. A guy looked at this earlier today, and he said, is that an American robin trying to drown himself? And I said, no, Marty, it's not. I said, that's an American dipper. And he did know that. And American dippers are cool because they're a passerine bird, so they don't have web feet. They're like a robin. And they make their living diving underneath of fast-moving streams where they're eating aquatic insects. And guess what else they depend upon? Salmon eggs. They're one of 138 different vertebrate species in this area that depend on one or more life forms of salmon. So it's pervasive. Let's take another example. So this is a marble murrelet. Marble murrelets are alcids. They're kind of the northern counterpart to a penguin. They dive under the water. They can dive down 50 feet. They're flying with their wings. They're catching small fish, and then they're flying back sometimes 40 miles into the old growth forest where they've made their nests on these horizontal branches, and they're feeding their young fish that they caught 40 miles away in the open ocean. That connection is there between the land and the sea. You just have to keep looking for it. And if you don't believe me, look at this satellite image. And I don't have to tell you where we are. I think you can see us in the picture here. But this beautiful turquoise water is the Fraser River freshet. It's the snow melt off of the Fraser River that's sending its plume out into the Salish Sea. This is fresh water coming out, 2.6, 2.8 million gallons of water a second when this is happening. And I think you saw this on the Orion a little bit earlier tonight. You see on the right is the drinkable, somewhat fresh water, and on the left is the non-drinkable salt water. And remember, fresh water is more buoyant than salt water. So that fresh water sits on the surface, and it sits anywhere from 6 to 33 feet deep on the top of that plume. And it's this mixing fresh water that's coming down is a little bit of nutrients, but it's really oxygen rich. And the water that's coming up from the depths of the open ocean, coming in the Strait of Juan de Fuca, is really nutrient rich and really oxygen poor. And it hits the Gulf Islands, it hits the San Juan Islands, just like a big egg beater. And it mixes up and it starts the foundation for the phytoplankton and the zooplankton and the plankton that you can even see with your eyes, like this egg yolk jellyfish. And it just starts that whole nutritious chain going up and fuels the productivity for this inland sea that's it's more productive than the open ocean. And people always make the mistake of saying it's a dark place. We don't have the colors. Every single color that you could find on a tropical coral reef, you can find in the Salish Sea. And I love this picture by Mark Chamberlain because he was smart enough. He didn't just take this shot. He went a little closer. And I always encourage you to do that. When you think you see something, look a little bit closer. And what you see are these black and white sea fleas that are here that are making their life on the tentacles of that anemone. That's kind of a fun game, so let's do that again. So you see this, a crimson anemone, right? And thank you, Mark Chamberlain, again. And then let's go a little bit deeper. And what do you see here? The most beautiful shrimp in the world is candy stripe shrimp. Candy stripe because it's delicious to look at, not to eat. And what's it doing? It has a symbiotic relationship with the anemone, right? It's protecting that anemone from other shrimp species that may come in there and try and pick at it and damage that anemone. And it's living off of things that anemone doesn't ingest and feed itself. So it's this symbiotic relationship, very similar to Disney's Finding Nemo, right? But much more beautiful. So Walt Disney, eat your heart out on this one. And the Salish Sea, it's full of all of these different complexities that are out there. And so, you know, we talked about sea star wasting disease. Dr. Helena has done some research with that, as well as Dr. Marliaff here at the Vancouver Aquarium. Everything that's happening out there, you have these complex predator-prey relationships that Dr. Marliaff was talking about earlier. Now, they're every bit as interesting as a cheetah running down a Thompson's gazelle on the plains of Africa. Sometimes they occur more slowly, but they're every bit as interesting. So what you see here in this still, this is a leather sea star, right? And it's coming up to try and eat this swimming anemone. But the anemone is not going to just let it happen. So I'm going to show you a little video, right? Anemone is going to, it sees the leather star coming in. It's saying, no, no way, Batman. Raises itself up, comes down, strikes him down. And then he says, I'm out of here. Remember, a lot slower than the Thompson's gazelle and the cheetah. And that leather star is thinking, God, if I had a head, I would have a headache right now. And the anemone is still thinking he's getting really far away. And just when you think you've seen everything, something else comes in, right? And that's what I love about this, because the copper rockfish comes in to say, oh, maybe there's something in there for me to eat. So these things are going on all the time, and you have to look at what's happening to really try and understand it. So remember we talked about the beauty of the color, and here's a different complexity. So this is a giant barnacle. It's the world's largest barnacle. Not this one that they took a picture of, but this species, right? Big as a softball. And what you see are the cirri, the legs of this barnacle. Remember that barnacle stuck in there on his head, and he's shifting his legs out there, and he's grabbing that plankton, bringing that in with these cirri. And if you look at the fins of this grunt sculpt, and they look a lot like the cirri of that giant barnacle, right? Because that's what he wants them to look like, because he likes to hide out in the dead giant barnacles. He doesn't want other animals to predate him. He wants to look like the barnacle, and he wants to be able to catch something to eat. And don't make the mistake that I make a lot of times of, I call it the naming mistake. You think you know something, and you give it a name. You say, oh, this is a western gull, or this is a glaucous wing western hybrid, probably, or this is a kelp crab. And then sometimes, as a scientist, we like to throw in like a Latin name. Pugetia producta, that's the kelp crab. And people say, oh, he really knows about. But look at the picture, and they'll tell you that their lives are every bit as complex as our lives, with a lot less traffic. And so what's happening, this gull is going to eat this crab. And this crab is pretty certain, he knows it's his last day. But he's not going down without a fight. And he knows he's got just a little pincher. He's going to go, he's saying, I'm going to get you. I'm going to go for the eye. And then what's he saying with his other arm? If I had a middle finger right here, I would be giving you the finger, giving the bird, right? And so, and these things are happening all the time, and they'll tell you what's going on. They'll tell you about the life histories. This picture of this gull, this tells you that this gull is a generalist. This gull is going to eat anything that he can fit into his mouth, and even some things like this ochre star that he can't fit into his mouth. But let's look at this picture of the rhinoceros auklet. The rhinoceros auklet is a specialist, right? And this bird makes its living, remember it's an alcid like the marble murrelet, so it makes its living diving under the water, flying with its wings, and catching little schooling fish to bring back to its young. It spends its whole life on the water, except when it maybe excavates or re-excavates a burrow that can be about 15 feet deep. And my question to you is, if you're a diving bird that catches a fish to bring back to your young, how do you catch a fish, come up for some air, go back down and catch another fish without losing the first fish? Maybe you tuck it under your wing or something. No, they actually have little things on their bill and on their tongue that allow them to impale that fish. So when they open up their bill, they can grab another fish without losing that first fish. And this is like a unit of measurement. This is what scientists call a billful of fish. And if you weigh all of the fish in that bill and you use a bomb calorimeter, there may be 4 or there may be 12, but they're probably going to have about the same caloric density. So this bird knows when he's got a billful, time to go home, time to feed the babies, right? And it's not happening independently. What's happening right there, so you see there's some rhinoceros auklets over here, there's some common murres over here, they're diving down. These common murres can dive almost 600 feet deep, right? And they're schooling these bait fish, they're pushing them to the surface, and the gulls are plunge diving down and eating them, and the humpback whale is coming in, thank you very much, taking the whole bait ball of fish. So all of these things are happening all of the time. And we just are getting little snapshots of what's going on. Let's take the bait that was in that bird's bill, right? These sand lance. Now, most fish, when they bury themselves, they don't truly bury themselves. Think of a flatfish, okay? English sole or CO sole or something. They come down, they settle on the floor, a muddy, sandy bottom of the ocean, and they start to kind of wiggle like a bunch of college kids in a mosh pit. And then the sand and the mud comes up and it settles down on their back and it kind of camouflages them. And this is a unique fish, this sand lance, in that it really drives itself into the sand. It comes down, hits the sand with its nose, the tail starts waving back and forth, drives itself about two-thirds of the way into the sand, and then it sucks itself in. So even the prey items are just as interesting as the predators that we're talking about as we're going along. And then take this one, for instance. There's always these things we don't know about, right? You guys are aquarium people, you're Georgia Strait Alliance people. You know this fish. I saw my first one of these about a month or two ago when I was diving. Now, this looks like a fish and a rat started a family, right? And it's aptly named the ratfish, right? And it has a poisonous spine. They don't get very big, maybe, you know, half of a meter long. And yet, if you took all of the fish in the Salish Sea and weighed them by species, the highest biomass would be this species right here, the ratfish, a fish that most people couldn't even identify or even know that exists around this area. All of these things. Sharks. Nobody thinks of sharks when they think of the Salish Sea. But Salish Sea used to have so many basking sharks in it that they were considered a nuisance by people that were trying to catch salmon. So gill netters were out catching salmon, and these basking sharks can be about 30 feet long, right? And so that can kind of wreck your salmon fishing day when you get one of these caught in your net. And so DFO had the great idea that, hey, let's make a targeted fishery. And so they made a harpoon fishery, and they even built a boat that was designed to cut these guys in half. And they basically extirpated the basking shark from the Salish Sea. And it was a real tragedy because in places where they still have basking sharks. Now, basking sharks, they're not like the great white shark that's going to eat you off your surfboard. They're plankton eaters, right? They have their big mouth gaping. They have these gill rakers, and they're taking water in through their mouth and through their gills. 132,000 gallons of water an hour they're filtering, right? And they're filtering out the plankton. And so places where they have big populations of basking sharks, it's a multi-million dollar scuba and snorkeling industry. People are flying, buying hotels, eating expensive food, and going out just to spend time with these gentle animals. And what's even crazier than these animals is the guy that took this picture. And I like that story because this was a friend of mine, Florian Graner, who lives on Whidbey Island. And I said, Florian, when did you take this? He said, well, it was 2009. I was going up the west side of San Juan Island, and I saw the dorsal fin. There were two, maybe three. And I said, geez, nobody in their right mind would ever jump off of their boat on the west side of San Juan Island when the current is cooking and ever expect to see that boat again. And Florian said, I'm not stupid. I tied myself to a line, and then I jumped over the boat. And I thought, no, you're not stupid. lucky, brave, stupid, I don't know, it's a fine line. But the beauty of it was that he was able to capture these images of these basking sharks underwater, video and still, to remind us that this is a heritage that we used to have in this place and we can still have in this place and bring them back, be an economic advantage, and come back, not for us to decimate again, but for us to really enjoy and to honor for being here. I got to show this, not because it's that fantastic, but this is probably one of my favorite fish. So this is the Pacific spiny lump sucker. There's lots of lump suckers out there. And these guys, terrible, terrible swimmers. And they have these modified pelvic fins that allow them to suck down on things because when the least little bit of current or wave comes through, they're kind of struggling. And I just want to show you this quick video of the Victoria High School made because I think it shows it really well. And I'll try and narrate it for you. So you see the spiny lump sucker here. He's swimming along, gets a little current. He has to suck down. Now, I like the gunnel, because the gunnel's looking at him. He's going like, really? Do you really consider yourself a fish? And he's thinking, whoa, it got dangerous out there. You know, I mean, and that guy is cute, right? And so where is Walt Disney when they need to make something? I mean, it's right here in our backyard, right? And we're full of this, right? Over 250 different species that we have in this area. And then one of the nice things that's really cool, and this is for my friend Rob Butler, is that we talked a lot about species that are here in the Salish Sea year-round, but the Salish Sea is also a stopping ground for all kinds of different species that depend on this, okay? And Audrey wrote it beautifully when she said, it's epic journeys that are stitched together by the feathers of a million wings. And that's really what these shorebird migrations are. These birds are moving from the Arctic all the way down to Central America and sometimes even South America, like these Dunlin taking off here. And some of these birds are very small, right? Western sandpiper may weigh 25 grams. And so they are not giving out food on airplanes anymore. They're not even giving out peanuts. And these guys got to stop. They got to eat something along the way. And it's places like the Salish Sea and places like Delta Port right here by Tsawwassen that are really profound for them to come in and refuel along their journey. So there are animals that a lot of times we don't consider as part of this place, but the Salish Sea is every bit as critical for their life forms. And there are other birds that come down too, like this beautiful picture that Connor has here. You know, when we think of these snowy owls with Harry Potter, and we don't, they're even a bird that we don't have every year in the Salish Sea. But for the survival of the species, the Salish Sea is critical. So you have a lemming population that goes up. These birds, their population goes up, the lemmings, and these birds are coming down to the Salish Sea where they're coming along the shorelines of Boundary Bay and areas like that. They're hunting during the day, and what are they eating? Not lemmings. They're eating seabirds and sea ducks and grebes and shorebirds and things like that. So this is an area that's important for them, not individual birds, not every year, but for the entire species as it goes along. And so just like I told you, don't make the naming mistake where you think if you can name something, oh, this is an American mink. Don't make the scientific mistake of thinking you know everything about it, because I know this animal weighs about a kilo. I know that it can dive to about 3 meters deep. I know which kind of crabs it likes to eat. But I never would have expected this guy to do a belly flop. But there it is. So just have to take the extra second. And that's a good belly flop. I've judged competitions in Fort Lauderdale before. That's a winner right there. And you have to, when you start to think, we have all of these mammals and all of these birds who breathe air, yet make most of their entire living underwater. It's just a phenomenal thing to think about. And we talked about killer whales before. We actually have three different types of killer whales in the Salish Sea. I think it's probably one of the most unique areas, maybe next to Antarctica or something. This is a southern resident. It's a little bit hard to see, but that southern resident is coming up with that salmon in its mouth. And what's it doing? It's coming up because more times than not, these female southern residents are going to catch a fish, and they're going to prey share. They're going to bring it up, just like Chester, that pseud orca here, would prey share. They're going to bring it up. They're going to share that with another killer whale. And we also have ones. We have ones that would strand on the beach, these killer whales. We'd find them, and half of their dental arcade would be worn down. And we were really trying to figure out what's going on. Well, John Ford at DFO and other people who are studying these things, these offshore ecotypes are specialists in eating sharks. And we think that it's the scales, these placoid denticles, the sandpaper-like skin that's wearing down their teeth. And then we have the transient killer whales, the mammal eaters, the non- so politically correct mammal eaters that we have in this area. And I love this picture here because this is a photo that Jim Maya took, and it reminds us all that everything we do, whether it be on land or in the water, impacts the Salish Sea. We have very good evidence. These guys, some people may look and say, oh, they're having a good time, and some people may say, oh, they're terrified. We have very good evidence from multiple scientific papers right now that shows that killer whales, they don't live in a visual world. They live in an acoustic world, the world of Stevie Wonder, right? So they depend on sound to communicate with each other and to find food. And science is showing us that when these guys are in the presence of increased vessel noise, they do the same thing we do at a rock concert, or the same thing my dad does when he speaks to a non-native English speaker. He speaks louder and slower. And the killer whales are doing the same thing, and you can just kind of imagine, hey, do you have one over there? Right? Or the same thing with their echolocation. They're sending this sound out through their melon. It's coming back. It's bouncing. It's going through their jawbone to their ears. And we know that increased underwater noise decreases the distance at which that echolocation works. So we're really all connected. And connected in ways, you know, each of the animals that we've talked about tonight makes their living from the Salish Sea. We have different methods of harvesting, we have different tools, we have refrigerators, things like that, but we too are every bit as dependent on having a healthy and biodiverse Salish Sea as those animals that we talked about earlier. And there are ways that we are getting better at trying to figure out how much can we take and how much do we need to leave for the ecosystem? And what are ways that we can do it to minimize bycatch and maximize our enjoyment of what we are taking or harvesting? But it's not just about harvesting, right? We have lots of resources. This is a world mecca for cold water scuba diving. And things like whale watching, things like bird watching, things like scuba diving, these non-extracting activities are also economic drivers for this area. They bring multiple billions of dollars into the Salish Sea for people that are coming to enjoy that sort of a thing. And I love this picture that was taken out at the mouth of the Strait of Juan de Fuca because it reminds us of all the different components that are going on. So you see there's timber, and it reminds us the connectivity with the land. You see the boat, it reminds us of the vessel traffic. You see the recreation, you see the surfers, you see the kayakers. And what's happening in this picture? Everybody is sharing space and time. And there is possibility for us to have harvest, for us to have timber harvest. All of these things are not innately bad. It's just a matter of doing it at levels that are sustainable into the future for generation after generation. And so when you look at a place like Vancouver, and you see, it really is not the skyscrapers or the skyscape that defines these places around the Salish Sea. It really is the sea itself that laps at the shore. It's the Salish Sea that creates these million-dollar views. It's the Salish Sea that's providing food that fills everybody's belly. It's the Salish Sea that's providing the things that fill our spirit. And so we are the Salish Sea, and I think that's the way we need to be thinking about that. And I love this picture here. This is taken not too far from here, but these are Squamish and Tsleil-Waututh and Musqueam and other First Nations. And they're not just protesting the expansion of a pipeline into their native areas. They are actually protecting their culture from impacts. And they are protecting resources that are not only important to them, but that are important to all of us. And so I want to leave you tonight with a couple thoughts Audrey and I have as a closing, is really our vision for the Salish Sea. So we envision the day when people know the creatures and the resources of the Salish Sea as well as they know their corporate logos. And we envision a day when people monitor and watch the ecosystem as much as they monitor the weather and their bank accounts, and the NASDAQ and the Dow Jones Industrial Average. And we also envision a day when people care and steward for these resources like their lives and their livelihoods depend on them, because they do. And so this is a quote that I'd like to leave you with today. This is an E.B. White quote that we have in the book. I arise in the morning torn between the desire to save the world and a desire to savor the world. And that makes it hard to plan the day. And the goal in us putting this quote up here is not to make it hard for you to plan your day tomorrow when you wake up. But I think it's a really profound thing for us to remember is that we have and we live in one of the most amazing places on earth. We have all of these resources. And for us to spend our days and to not savor this place is a crime. We need to go out there. We need to enjoy it. We need to eat the delicious food it provides. We need to enjoy the scenery and the birds. But we also have a societal obligation to ourselves and to future generations to save this place. And so we're sitting here tonight, 25th anniversary of the Georgia Strait Alliance, the Vancouver Aquarium that's allowing you to get close to all of these things. And as citizens of Vancouver, I'm encouraging you, be a part of those groups. Donate tonight. All of your donations will be spread between those groups. Use those groups as tools that allow you to savor and to save this place. Thank you all for coming out, and happy World Ocean Day. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Joe. That was amazing. Any questions for our speakers? Right here on the left.
Yeah, so the question is, what has happened to the seaweed? Elders in Lummi Nation have told her that they used to go down and gather it by the armsful. And I know that there are people that study kelp forests, and there are people that study other different types of seaweed, but I'm not familiar with anybody that's been doing a kind of a systematic scientific survey to see what's available out there. I do know there's a resurgence in collecting, in harvesting, and eating seaweed. And I do know that CDOC has a project right now that's looking at contaminant levels in seaweed so we can tell people, hey, there is risk or there's not risk. But I don't actually know, have data that I can share with you on population abundances and things like that. Anybody have a question I know the answer to? My daughter's middle name. Hey, thanks a lot. We'll be signing some books out here later. So.
So again, I'd like to thank Joe, Kevin, and Jeff for their wonderful insights. That notion of savoring and saving, I think, is a challenge to all of us as well, to go out there, to get involved, and to do what we can, be it supporting these organizations or with our sweat equity, with programs like the Great Canadian Shoreline Cleanup, supporting programs like Oceanwise, or the British Columbian Cetacean Sightings Network. If you have any more questions this evening, Joe, Jeff, and Kevin will be available in the lobby, and we'll be available as well as aquarium staff. So you've heard us talk about things like the Coastal Ocean Research Institute. We'd love to talk to you more about that, and we will be celebrating. It's time to turn the page and look forward to the next 25 years for the Georgia Strait Alliance. We have cake. Our online visitors won't get to enjoy that. But we will be doing that shortly after we end. One final housekeeping note, our next program will be June 16th. We will be having a documentary film on the Great Bear Sea. So if you'd like to know more, please check our website out at www.vanacqua.org for more information. And we look forward to seeing you then. Thank you very much, everyone, and have a great night.